Okay, welcome everyone. Good morning. It's a pleasure to have Dr. Vivek Tiwari talk to us today. It's an opportunistic talk. It turned out that he was in town and we were able to get him. He's a very busy person, but so we're in for a treat. It's really very nice to have him come and talk to us. So let me tell you a little bit about him. We've interacted for quite some time since when he was a PhD student at Princeton. He received his BTech in CSE from IIT Delhi in 91 and a PhD in EE from Princeton in 96. And some of his work in the doctoral dissertation has had a lot of impact in looking at how you estimate power in software, and that had a lot of impact. So after that, he joined Intel, and he's been at Intel for several years, holding a variety of technical positions. Currently, he's a director of platform technology, strategy, and management in the client computing group at Intel. Intel seems to be competing with IBM for acronyms. Maybe there's a ABCDEFG. So a little bit about what he's done. He's done a bunch of stuff. He was director of the Software Program Office in Visual and Parallel Computing, and he was director of Silicon Platform Technologies. And early on in his career, he was looking at tools and techniques for analyzing and reducing power consumption in Intel's products. So a really wide technical depth and breadth of cool stuff happening at Intel. And you know, he has a bunch of different awards. I won't go through them. It'll take us too long. But you can read his abstract. He's had a lot of best people awards, journals, books. So he's well published and very well respected. So he's going to share with us some of his thoughts on power challenges. And so let's welcome Dr. Tiwari.
Thanks, Nick, for the opportunity and kind words. I've had the pleasure of knowing Nick for a really long time, and he helped me provide some. Can you hear me fine at the back? He helped me guide some of my early work, and then we interacted later too. We have some papers together, so glad to have the opportunity to come here. It just worked out really well because I'm here tomorrow for a conference, a program committee conference, ISLP, International Symposium of Low Power Electronics and Design. The first of those was held in 1994 in Napa. It was a workshop. I think then it got converted into a conference in 95. So it's been over 23 years, almost, right? It's 23 years for that conference. And one of the themes right from the start of the conference has been, do we need this conference? Do we need a conference focused on power? Hasn't the power problem been solved? Every few years we have this soul searching conversation. So, and you know, we've always felt, no, there's always a need to work on power. So that's what I wanted to bring that perspective, having worked in power myself now for almost 25 years, more than that, since then. So this will be a personal perspective. It's, you know, I'm not going to go into too much detail on topics. And I have to go through this because, you know, these are my opinions. They're not Intel's opinions. Not that they're necessarily, you know, that we disagree, but officially, please don't take this and, you know, I shouldn't hopefully read a blog post that Intel has disclosed XYZ about Moon's Law. As a shortcut, I grabbed a bunch of pictures, etc., from the internet. I think I feel like I should say that. They may be copyrighted materials, so I've referenced them. But please, if you take any pictures, please don't post them anyway. All right. Before I go further, I want to just get a show of hands just for my own calibration. How many folks are from EECS? And CS? Alright. So that helps me get some idea. By the way, I was in grad school. I had to take classes in EE as well as in computer science. That was part of our expectations. So my technique was, if I was in EE class, and I would basically tell everyone, hey, I'm a computer science guy, I don't know anything. And if I would go into a CS, I would say, I'm from the EE department, I don't know anything there. Luckily, nobody asked me and said, well, what do you actually know? You don't seem to know either. And that works very well. It works at Warp also, because I can go into a business meeting and I say, hey, I'm just a dumb engineer. You guys are the marketing guys. You can figure it out. And vice versa. So I can go to the architecture meeting and they're talking about some deep technical stuff, and I can say, oh, I'm the platform guy. So that's a useful technique. I'm not encouraging that you use that. So before we start, you have to start with the obligatory Moore's law of the foil. And the reason, and this is not just because I work for Vishal, but the reality is that this really is the industry. I mean, if you are here, whether you know it or not, you know, your lives have been impacted by this. And this is, in fact, the last 30, 40 years, everything that's happened in the industries has happened, and now in everyday life, is happening because of this thing that's happening behind the scenes, which is Moore's law. Without anybody working too hard, most people not working too hard, except some process technologists, we get double the performance every 2 years. We get double the number of transistors every 2 years. It's just happening like magic. Some people are working really hard, the physicists, the material scientists, the mechanical engineers who have to define these very high accuracy steppers that are moving at an error tolerance of a micron or less. So, but most of us get the advantage of Moore's law. Every 2 years, and this is an approximate number, right? Every 2 years, number of transistors double, performance doubles. And oh, by the way, power reduces.
Just wanted to say, I don't think the performance doubles. The original Moore's law was transistors shrinking and performance doubling. So double the size, double the performance. But the performance aspect of it died a long time ago.
Right. I think it's become a buzzword. I think it helps as a useful model. Right? The original paper that Gordon Moore wrote was more to do with number of devices. And he was working on a very starting point was very small. It was only a few transistors. So you know he could plot a few. But the amazing thing is that line that he plotted, I'm not going to in his original article that he wrote, he plotted it out for a few years. Right? And now this has been going on for 30, 40 years. Which is very rare in any industry to keep an exponential going like that. So where does it come in terms of power? Part of the advantage was that there was an inherent benefit in CMOS that gives us a power benefit. So I'll go through one foil on that, and I know a lot of folks here are CS, but this is still relatively high level, right? So this is the magic of CMOS scaling, or there was actually a name for it called Dennard scaling. So if you look at a basic CMOS transistor, if you use a scale parameter of k, what happens is your device dimension, the key parameters, the oxide thickness, the length, and the width of the transistor, so you scale it all proportionally by k, and then some of the other transistor parameters like doping concentration, you scale the voltage lower by saying k, the current through the channel scales by k, the capacitance scales down by k, and what that means then is that frequency, which is performance, which is essentially the inverse of delay, that scales by k as well. So you are getting a smaller transistor, and it's actually faster. A smaller transistor means you can put more devices together, and it's actually faster. Then power dissipation, and we'll go over this in a second. Just think of three parameters, capacitance, voltage, and frequency. So as we just saw, all of these are going down. And actually in proportion, you know, the frequency goes up, we get a quadratic benefit from voltage, so net-net power dissipation for a transistor goes scales down by quadratic. And overall power density stays the same because the number of devices. So there's almost nothing else in industry that works this way, that you get benefits all the way through. And actually this translates into money, dollar savings, price savings, cost savings, whatever. This is what kept us going in this industry. So that's great, right? So we're seeing performance and power coming from three under the Dennard scale. So great, so we should have been able to continue to do this. So what happened? If you actually look what happened, our trend here for number of transistors, it's been going on for the last 40 years, it just keeps on going. This has translated into number of cores since we went into the realm of parallelism and multiple cores. So that's been going up. Power originally going up started to stagnate, and we'll talk about why here, right? That's the constraint. And then frequency was going up, performance was going up, started to stagnate. So we just saw Dennard scaling. So you know that's great. Why did this happen? So now what's happening is now we're entering the realm of quantum mechanics, believe it or not. So how many people here have heard of quantum tunneling? What a few. That was good. So if you don't, all right, what I'm going to say next, please close your ears, because I may be completely hashing it out, right? But believe it or not, you just took a picture with that server, right? The number of pixels you got with that is actually dependent on quantum tunneling, right? And just so it's like a quantum effect that's having a macro effect, not just on in terms of what you're getting, in terms of what's happening on Wall Street, which companies are the winners and the losers, and why is this happening? So what quantum tunneling is that, just think of it this way. This is how a physicist explained it to me. So you know, this is good enough for me. You have an electron. Maybe think of it as a particle. But think of it, actually, it is more of a probability waveform, right? It's a wave function. So you have a barrier, and you have a wave function here. Now let's say you have a barrier here. The wave function, if you bring that electron close enough, part of that wave function is now on the other side of the barrier. Now, if you have a lot of electrons, it just turns out that the probability that some of them are now on the other side of that barrier is in proportion to that wave function. So just like magic, this is a barrier, it's a potential barrier. You're not supposed to have an electron go across that. And because of a quantum phenomenon, it turns out that probabilistically speaking, you will expect to see some electrons on the other side of the barrier. And sure enough, you do. So that's the magic. You can't explain this in classical physics. There's no good formulas for it in classical physics, only in quantum. So what happens then is that you are reaching the realm of quantum physics because your oxide thickness has reached a point. It doesn't scale any further. So now these quantum effects are impacting Reynolds scaling. So that's the fundamental reason, and we'll talk about it a little bit more. Why this started to happen. So just a quick, let's just quickly talk about, I'm sure you've looked at this before. Just remember three things. There are two sources of power consumption, dynamic and static. So dynamic power consumption at a macro level, capacitance, which think of it just as the size of the circuit, the number of devices, voltage, frequency, and activity. And these things are related. The activity, how many times you switch a transistor, and if you use it as a probability function, then multiply by the frequency, that's the number of times it switches on an average sense. The number of devices, the voltage they're running at, and how fast they're running at. That gives you dynamic power. Okay, so we know this. Can we reduce power consumption? We can just look at these three parameters, and that gives an idea. Let's think about it as a demo here, right? So we have lights on in this room. So you're using a certain amount of energy in this room. If I ask you to reduce the power consumption of this room, of the back of the bulbs in this room, what will you do? Any ideas? Some ideas on how to reduce the power consumption. It's not too hard. I can ask my kids to do the same thing. Turn it off. That's right. Go turn it off, right? We can turn it off. That's the biggest way to do it. What else? So that's activity. So we can reduce. We only use the lights when we need them. Other ideas?
Dim them.
Pardon?
Dim the lights.
Dim the lights. Exactly. There's a dimmer here. Dim the lights. That's voltage. That's a very powerful function. You can do that very. In fact, at our homes, at my home, we run at 90% of the peak, and that's supposed to give us a significant benefit, like 25-30% benefit, as far as these bulbs. Other ideas?
Reduce heat loss in the bulbs and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, exact materials, right? You can change the materials, you can go to a different technology, you can go to a CFL. So those are a few things. Now let's talk about design. What else can they do? I can ask half of you guys to move over to this side and then shut off the lights on this side. So we are more efficiently using the resources we have. So if you just got those few of those concepts, that's basically what some of us who've been talking about power for the last 35 years, that's basically what we've been doing. It's literally those few things that we just talked about. Various forms of that, applying that a little bit more smartly, but those are the big bang things, turning things off, go with, well, of course, we can like reduce the number of lights in the room. Fewer devices, more efficient voltage, keep pushing the voltage down, and use them only when necessary. Those are the basic concepts. And that works very well with dynamic power. Now, with leakage, so leakage, we already talked about the gate tunneling leakage. If you want to think about the, you know, the simple architecture level model for it, just think of it as that there is a process parameter, and then there is the number of devices. So it's actually the transistor width, the gate width, but think of it as a process. So if you want to reduce gate leakage or the sub-threshold leakage, which is the leakage through the source to the drain, just think of them as I take the total number of devices, which gives me the gate width, and I have a gate parameter, which is fixed for each technology, and that's my number for leakage. So how do I reduce leakage? I reduce the number of devices. That's number one. I can reduce voltage. That's similar to for dynamic. And I can turn things off. And for turning things off, for a leakage, you have to actually have to power gate. On dynamic power, you can clock gate, but here you have to power gate. Basic, these are the basic things that have been working well. Now the problem, okay, so we talked about power. Now let's talk a little bit about why does it matter. And I'm sure you've heard a lot about this in the context of thermals. Chips get hot, you know, they fail, so you have to cool them down. Power distribution, you have devices now, 100 watts at less than a volt, so you have 100 amps of current, running at 4 gigahertz. And you're trying to get this into a little device. So think of the power distribution problem there, the inductive losses, the resistive losses. Taking care of these adds cost to the system. Like normal data is that if any power consumption above 40 watts, you spend $1 per watt to cool and do the power delivery for a CPU. And it's $2 a watt for graphics, because graphics tends to be voltage. A significant portion of our platform cost is now going into power delivery and thermals. And this whole industry, believe it or not, the PC industry, is almost like a commodity business right now. The Dell, HPs, Lenovo's, there are a few companies who have the capacity to do some R&D. Everybody else is like really going after the last penny. If you add one penny to the BOM cost of a platform, that's a big, big deal, because they are operating in such thin margins. So anything that can be done on, you know, outside of the silicon cost, anything that they can save on the platform, it's as a direct profit for those companies. As we go to mobile, the power consumption becomes a factor with batteries. So batteries, the battery weight, the size, that's the problem. And the usable lifetime, if you have to go replace a battery, if you have an iPhone, the battery degrades, what do you have to do? It's a problem for you. If you in the old days, we could go replace an Android phone, mostly you could go replace the batteries, even they are moving in that direction. So then the lifetime of the battery matters, which is related to how much power you drain. When we now take the same thing, scale it up to a data center, you get the energy cost of the utility. That starts becoming a factor. Your data centers, you cannot build a data center in Silicon Valley anymore. If you build it, it has to go through a whole kinds of regulatory processes, and then you are paying some of the most expensive energy costs in the country. So there's an incentive to figure out how do you reduce the energy cost per data center. Now, the costs vary, the estimates vary a lot. Initially, we got some data points that 25% of the cost of a data center is related to cooling and power delivery. We've got data points from Google. They basically say that half the cost of a data center is cooling and power delivery. So this is not that, this is like wasted power. This is power that just, no, this is leakage, right? This is energy drains, used, wasted energy. So everything that you're seeing, your comms, your communication, compute, all the value add, that's only half of what's happening today. So there's a huge incentive there. And then there are other costs too, and which may not be visible to the end customer in certain cases, but inside a company, if you're a large manufacturing house, the design verification complexity related to power management is huge. I have a saying that every power management feature ever. If you build, you come up with a low power saving idea, come up with a power management idea, you can guarantee that there will be a bug. Think about that for a second. Why is it that any power management feature I've added, I'll have a bug in? Because people still think of this as something different. You design your adders, your multiplexers, your CNN, and then you design it, they say, okay, I should do something about power. Let me add a power management capability, let me scale the voltage, let me add a control unit. It always comes in later. Clock gating, I built my clock network, now let me add a clock gating to it. So it always comes in later. It's never simulated in your C code, in your C models. It's rarely simulated in RTL. It's never simulated in the circuit design. So if you don't simulate something, you can guarantee you'll have a bug. That's what happens with power management. And it adds up in terms of the time to market, et cetera, and it's happening a lot across all companies. And then if you are an end customer or user, right, the noise from the fans, that can be quite a bottleneck. If you have old desktop systems at home, if you buy a new one, by the way, you should go buy the new one, it's a better power management. If you have an old one, the fan sounds like it's a chainsaw running inside the system. So those are all hidden cost problems. I won't go into this much detail on this one, but I think by now, hopefully, you get the point that if you look at the entire world today, right, we call it the smart connected world, whether you start at the edge, you have mobile devices, you have your traditional clients, desktops, comms, and then eventually the data centers. All of them are working under a constraint that is somehow related to power. You can think of a client, we just talked about the fan noise, the decibels, the cost of cooling and thermals. And even the energy cost, if you're in a high cost utility area like we are in the Bay Area. When you're talking about a server, you're talking about amps of current, you're talking about the rack, the impact of the form factor, because it depends on how many servers can you fit in a rack. Because the economy of scale of data centers, you have to have standard rack sizes, standard chassis. So you have to fit within that. It's how much compute can I squeeze within one new form factor? So the volume matters there. The noise matters. Imagine being in a data center. You have to have earphones when you walk in there. And similarly, the megawatt level data centers, the cost of utility. Then you go down to mobile devices. You're talking about the form factor of the device, how small it can get, the battery lifetime. And then you go to the IoT, which is now exploding. So IoT is everywhere. You're talking about, if you're talking about smaller devices or sensors, how many ounces of it, the weight, the size. If it's an embedded system with an embedded battery, its useful lifetime depends on how much power is it consuming. You're not going to go back and replace the battery. Then suddenly your whole economic value proposition goes out. You send a maintenance guy to go replace batteries. So no matter what segment you are in, right now you're power constrained. So back here, so our good old days here, where we could keep increasing frequency, number of devices, even at the cost of increasing power, that became a problem because power became deconstrained. When I was working on my thesis, I was writing up my thesis in 1996. In my introduction, I put a statement in there. I said, power consumption will constrain what we can do with computer architecture. What kind of CPUs we can build. Right? So this was 1996. And my advisor said, you can't make statements. He understood it. I'm not saying anything. Sharad understood it. Right? But he said, you are just a young PhD student. You can't make brash statements like that. So go find a reference for it. I had to work very hard to find a reference that made a similar statement. That I eventually found a microprocessor report, some article in microprocessor report. So that's in my, if you look at my thesis, there's a reference that power consumption will become the constraint on what we can do with computing devices. It's some obscure reference in a microprocessor report. When I came to Intel, the initial few days, I remember a conversation I had with one of our computer architects. They were building the next, Titanium, right? The IA64, supermassive VLIW designs. So we were going from 100 watts to 200 watts. because even with Moore's law, if you double the number of devices or you go beyond the scaling of what Moore's law gives you, you can actually increase power consumption. So he said, yeah, we're going to build 200 watts. Our technology guys have figured out a way to cool it. You know, yes, there's some power delivery issues. We can put more inductors on the package, below the package. We can do 200 watts. So I said, can I have a look at your power estimate? So I looked at his power estimate. And I said, okay, yeah, so you're doing the CV square. What about leakage? He said, what do you mean leakage? And he was one of our key architects at Intel. Leakage was not in anybody's mindset at the time. We did the estimate for leakage. It was 100 watts. So that, you know, just simple. Number of devices, took the process technology file, 100 watts. Suddenly the product is 300 watts. Became a big problem. Eventually that roadmap was changed, right? So that constraint changed what we were planning to do here. Big impact on the industry. So this goes back to the end of the data scaling. When the original paper was written in 1974, you know, he did not factor in the fact that, yes, he said the VT, the threshold voltage A oxide also scaled down, was not a problem. But you are now at the point where these things are at 5 angstrom. When you get to 5 angstrom, we already talked about tunneling, right? So you're a few atomic layers thin. And this quantum mechanical effect that you cannot do anything electrically to prevent that. The only thing you can do is to increase the physical barrier. So that's why this new set of devices basically said you can't go so thin on your oxide, you have to keep it high. The impact of having a bigger oxide, a thicker oxide is you can't scale down the dynamic, the threshold voltage. If you can't scale down the threshold voltage, then you can't, you know, if you push your DCC lower, but you can't push down your threshold voltage, you lose the performance advantage. So that fundamental factor was not in the original Dennard scaling. And the problem that became is that now, yes, you can put more devices on a chip. You can still keep approximately to the Moore's law. And even that's becoming harder. If you got Intel's earnings report came out yesterday. I know at grad school you never pay attention to those. But you know, you can have a look at that. Intel actually publicly made a statement about 10 nanometers and the yield problems with 10 nanometers. And the fact that for 7 nanometers, it will go to extreme ultraviolet. So this is, you know, fundamental issues related to these things are now happening and they're visible to Wall Street. So we can pack in more devices. They are not as cheap as before, but you know, we won't get the performance unless we do something harder. And by the way, you'll hear the term dark silicon, right? So that's referring to the fact that yes, you can add more devices, but if you can't clock them, you can't use them because the power consumption goes too high, they're just sitting there idle. So it's dark silicon. And it can be an advantage. You can take it as a thing of it as an opportunity. You can think of smart ways to use these extra transistors, but you have to use them in a way that doesn't add to the overall power. So what that meant was that we had to make what's now known as a right hand curve. So if you go back here, you watch it this way, you're going up this way, now you suddenly have to make a right hand curve, which is what happened here. So now, in the good old days, this is a little bit of my personal perspective. When we started out here as a power researcher, in this period, these were the good old days. Yes, the performance was coming for free, but power was going up. And if there were not that many people who were interested in power, if you were a few of them, it was that you have low-hanging fruit, get papers written very easily, and not too many, there's not too much competition, things were good. But you still have to convince people that power matters. So, you know, that's any problem area, if you are in that early part of that problem area, it's good to be a researcher during that time. And then you get into this area where things became more constrained. So now power is a constraint. Wall Street became power aware. You know, they were picking winners and losers from a stock perspective based on what they think companies could do. And, you know, I had meetings where I had to explain. The Wall Street analysts would come in and I would be asked to go present to them as a power person to explain to them some of the basics of what we were going over today, right? And I would explain that, yeah, no, Intel has it figured out, don't worry. Or, I'll put it in another word, our competition doesn't have a way to beat the laws of physics. Laws of physics are the same, no matter what. Now, during this period, we have to work harder and smarter to deliver performance because it's not coming for free. And if you think about opportunities in your application domains, because if you just worry about frequency and you worry about single thread performance, you only worry about CPUs, it's not going to go too far. Now we have folks like Nick, who's, and you know, some of his collaborators from the early days, they were far ahead of the curve. You know, they were looking beyond CPUs, heterogeneous architectures, and you sometimes would have arguments because I would say, well, all this is great, right? But what I think matters is gigahertz. And general purpose computing and gigahertz. And the fact was, you're ahead of the curve or ahead of your time in that sense, right? So now it's catching up. Now we have to do all this hetero stuff, and we have to think of smarter ways to increase our performance because it's not no longer just gigahertz. So that's what this is all about now. That if you're in a power constrained world, how do you do a better job, or how do you increase your revenue? Because that's the ultimate business problem, right? So let's say we are sitting here. We have certain power consumption, certain performance, and it costs a certain amount of dollars. How do we increase our revenue? One way is, well, we can charge more for it. If we deliver more performance, we can charge more for it. Now remember, we can't increase the power consumption, right? So we have to figure a way to increase performance. We'll just call it a bin. You charge, you go up one bin of performance, you can charge more money for it, you increase your revenue. That's one way to go this way. So you keep your power the same, but figure out a way to deliver more performance. Alternatively, you can reduce the power consumption, reduce the price, reduce the cost of manufacturing the same product, sell it for cheaper, open up the market a little bit more, right? So increase the volume, your net revenue goes up, as long as you have price elasticity. So when you're in that part of the curve, reducing price increases demand, increases revenue. Great. Now, what if we do with both pieces? We have to reduce power. Whether you reduce power within the, you know, to give it more performance or bring the cost down. So reducing power opens up more segmentation options. And this is a fundamental thing that you will see in any area, in any constraint, by the way, right? If something becomes constrained, you segment and you figure out a way to choose that sub-problem domain that's more better optimized and figure a way to charge money for it. And in the case of power consumption, it's directly related to the DDU. So when we have roadmap discussions, it's people primarily focus on power. Because they know if I have lower power, I will jack up the frequency and I can get a higher performance part. Or I will just take it and create a lower cost product, in certain cases brand it differently. And you know, and be able to push it to a different market that you want to compete. So this is the how you do business in a power grid. So life does continue beyond our dinner scale, right? So this curve, if you were observant, you would have noticed that it ended in 2015. This was an old data point that I was able to get. We can easily extend these curves further. What has changed is that you won't see a curve for spec in. You see a curve for spec in rate. So the number of parallel cores. And then there's a lot that's been happening. So if you just look at some of our last two process technologies, starting at the original, starting at 130 nanometers, remember the concept of segmentation. So if threshold voltage cannot be reduced because of power problems, but I still need to reduce it, why don't I reduce it only for my critical path? So I can build for my high performance subset of the circuit where I need high performance. I'll have a lower VT for other places I want, so dual VT. Fundamental changes in the materials. Low K dielectric to reduce your interconnect resistance. IK in the gate, metal gate. So these were fundamental process breakthroughs that would help reset the curve. So we are on a certain curve, we get a momentary benefit, one-time benefit, because we switch to IK and metal. But then you're back to the same curve again. So now next time around, you have to figure something else out. Strained silicon gave us a momentary benefit. Now we are talking about tri-gate or FinFETs. Have you heard about FinFETs? FinFETs basically change the equation. Instead of trying to just keep squeezing the oxide, you go into third dimension, and then you can increase your gate width by going in the third dimension, and you don't have to reduce your TOX that much. Gives us a one-time benefit, then we'll be back on the same curve again. Circuits started out with the basic stuff we just talked about. Fewer devices, smaller devices, turn things off, clock gating. Now we have to get smarter. multiple supply voltages, trying to tackle the leakage effect. So that's been going on. And then microarchitecture, ultimately, is the, that is the biggest factor that determines what your overall power consumption will be. So you have to start thinking about it from the start. More cores, more multiprocessing, special purpose hardware. So while we get process technology innovations, you have to have your design fundamentals have to be power aware. And that's the only way you can deliver the right hand turn. And the key thing is that, and we already hinted at that, that you get away from simple measures of performance, like gigahertz or specking, and you can think about value performance. What do people actually care about? Do they really care about, as marketers, yes, we care about gigahertz, but as an end customer, do they really care about gigahertz? That's the fundamental change that came about with the right hand turn. So I'll give you a case study, because I was part of this, one of the shifts, right? So this happened in the early 2000s, around 2002, when we were, and I gave you an example already, right? We, our products were going up to 100, 200, 300 watt for the power projections, all for the sake of going for the next gigahertz, because our competition and us are locked in a battle for gigahertz. It became very clear that this was going to hit a power wall. So a decision was made that, okay, maybe we don't go for frequency anymore. Let's increase double the number of cores. Seems pretty obvious right now. It was a very major decision. There was a, there was some technology aspects we thought about. How do we test now? Right? We have all our test programs, and we had to do this in a hurry, by the way, because there was a roadmap crisis, and we had to go down to dual cores very quickly. How you have your test programs, which are written for a single core, now they have to handle a dual core. What do you have power delivery? Right? What about the operating system? The operating system understand. Luckily, Windows was good, the way it had been written, it would handle multiple cores. As long as we treated the cores just like they were multiple sockets, it didn't matter if you were. So a completely integrated approach across the whole company, and most importantly, marketing and customer awareness. The biggest battle was, we are in a gigahertz battle. Tomorrow we're trying to get to 4 gigahertz. That's the point that we made with them. Because we think we are ahead of AMD on our gigahertz. And then next day you want to come in and say, okay, this is a 2 gigahertz part, it's two of those. How do we convince people that that's the right thing to do? And how are we going to find, what are the apps, what are the applications? So these slides, which I won't go into detail, these are slides that my boss and I created. Well, a lot of people created and contributed those, but we presented these, including to Wall Street analysts, to explain to them, right? The idea here was to explain to people that parallelism matters, performance matters. That you can actually do a lot with parallelism. And we have to come up with all kinds of examples like, yes, most a customer won't care about a spec in trade, but don't most people have two windows open together? Things going on in parallel. By the way, somebody should collapse on that, right? In their original iPhone. They took it all the way back and said, you don't need to have multi-processing, you're happy with one app. But if you have multiple apps going, that's parallelism right there. This task level parallelism. In servers, you have things going on in parallel. You have to monitor what's happening in the data center. You're trying to do load balancing. There's a natural parallelism there. And of course, some things like search, and things which are inherently parallel, they will get the benefit anyway. For clients also, there's value. And then in those days, we used to call this RMS, which was recognition, mining, and synthesis. Now nobody needs to explain this anymore. In those days, all of this was a little bit hard to explain. Oh, vision? You care about vision? Why do you need vision? Right? And so anyway, the point was this was that it's not all about technology. This big turn, the CEO at the time, right? He was a visionary. In the sense, he said, okay, let's get out of this rat race on the gigahertz, we have to make the change. And that completely unlocked innovation in a very big way. And my boss at that time, when we were having this argument, I still remember that he told our marketing guys, he said, I'm not a marketing guy, but I'm sure you can figure out that 2 is better than 1. I'm sure you can figure out a way to sell that to a customer. So now what has happened since then, now we are caught in a core battle. have 32 cores, and I have 64 cores. And the same questions are opening up again. Why do we need so many cores? Who's going to get the benefit from it? But that's an example of value performance and starting to change from this gigahertz to what do customers really care about. Now, if we go forward, are we running out of opportunities, or will we have more opportunities for delivering value performance? Because we have to keep up our tenor scaling, right? I found a few things on the web here. I think this is worth looking at. There's a concept of this thing that what happens in an internet minute. And you can go back a few years and see what's happening in an internet minute. But in 60 seconds, the kinds of things that are happening. And it's very interesting to kind of look at some of that, right? And you can see some of your usual apps, searches, Facebook, Instagram. And if you look at this over multiple years, you can see which apps pop up as more important. While I'm here, Tinder. It seems to be going up. So I don't know what to say about that. Twitch. How many people know about Twitch? Listen, I'm asking the wrong audience here, right? If I was to ask, in my age group, nobody knows about Twitch. Kids know about Twitch. So, now, if you're a Tinder user, or let's say you're an Instagram user, do you care about what gigahertz you're running at? Do you care about how many GB, gigabits per second your memory network is capable of? You're just looking at what the value performance is. I'll skip the joke about value performance on Tinder. So, but you have certain areas of Twitch guys. Now, when you talk to the Twitch guys, they understand, the audience for Twitch, they understand, yes, I need gigabits. In fact, I need 3D mark. I need more than that, right? But that's value performance, it's gaming, it's the network bandwidth, because they're watching it live. That's what matters in that domain. And so you can take the same concept and expand it out, right? We've opened up the value of technology from a few people running general purpose stuff on a PC, and where they care about how fast you can run on a PC, the responsiveness of the PC, to now a whole class of the population of Earth, a significant fraction of that, who now care about performance but in very different ways. So if you take advantage of that, it opens up the door for what you can do with delivering performance in a powerful way. Let's look at IoT, right? Do you believe IoT is hype, or do you believe it's real? I believe it's true. I think maybe not the way people think about it today, but it's there. So it may not be this exponential curve, this 50 billion devices. It could actually be a lot more than that. Or it could be less than that, but the idea remains that IoT is now bringing another kind of value performance in a domain that was not your traditional performance domain. Another example is of autonomous cars. The kind of things that are going on simultaneously, right? The number of sensors you have. You are synthesizing the sensor information together. You have to make real-time decisions, potentially communicate with other cars. So there's communication, there's processing. So all those things that we talked about in the RNS slide, which we had such a hard time explaining to people before, all of that is happening in a self-driving car by itself automatically. So, and does power matter there? And that's a direct, by the way, it's a life-saving, it's a life-saving issue there, right? The amount of compute capabilities you can pack in the trunk of a self-driving car, how many Xeons or how many Tesla GPUs you can pack, that's a better job you can do. All of them are running on power, right? Even if you say that, okay, maybe I'll lose some gas mileage in pushing 500, 600 watts worth of computing, it's still a form factor issue. You lose trunk space because your whole trunk is full of the processors in the back. So power matters even in that space. And here's my favorite example, cryptocurrency, Bitcoin mining. There's nothing more direct about value performance than a Bitcoin, right? Bitcoining is amazing because it's nothing other than converting raw watts into dollars. That's all it is. It's a race between how much energy you consume to do your Bitcoin mining and whether you get rewarded because you are the winner and you come at the head of the block, or the head of the chain, and you get some money versus how much energy you consume. I found this this graph, and I think this I like it because it's very representative of a lot of different domains. So we can spend a few minutes talking about it. Let's say you started out early on, GPUs, right? So you run your hashing algorithm on a CPU. Very simple. You can download the code from the web. Pretty easy to do. You go for a faster CPU, add a few more, get one with multi-core, multi-threads. You know, you start getting some value out of it. Things were easy. You don't have that many zeros necessary in the, at the head of your hash. You could compute it in a CPU. So the whole point of a Bitcoin, the whole value proposition is that it has to be hard to make, which translates into how much energy it costs to create a Bitcoin. And that's the value prop. That's where the value comes from, is the amount of power it burns. So anyway, so at that time, this is the amount of performance, but it translates into power. Right? So then somebody figured out that I can take an old NVIDIA or an AMD GPU, run this inherently parallel code, which is nothing but additions. It's a sequence of multiplier additions. I can run it on my old GPU. I suddenly get an order of magnitude benefit. And now I can be profitable. So the stock price of NVIDIA and AMD, they don't talk about it. They always get asked in investor calls. And they always try to downplay the importance of crypto on their revenues. And in fact, if you're a gamer today, it's become very hard for you to find a used GPU card because all those are being sucked up by the crypto guys. So we got an order of magnitude benefit by going to a GPU. But then it's stagnated for a while. So you can get a certain inherent parallelism, but it's coming at a certain power cost. The next jump came with FPGAs. And then after that, the ASIC guys came in, Red Pig Main. They have a dedicated ASIC, and they are by far right now the biggest. They are the biggest winner right now. They have this dedicated device, a chip, which and it's a self-contained dedicated Bitcoin grid, the Antminer. Right? So the latest one is the Antminer S9. So you do a dedicated ASIC for that, you get another order of magnitude benefit, right? And this is in power consumption. This is a effectively the order of magnitude reduction in power consumption by going to more specialized and dedicated hardware. Then you get on the Moore's law benefit. So you're going from 55 to 28 to now their latest one is a 16 nanometer product. So you're seeing the benefit of Moore's law. You can also see it's going down, right, for the same reason we talked about. What's the next step? Did somebody figure out what's the best way to do better, you know, do this mining better? Probably not on this one, because there's only limited variability, right? So the next step is probably going to come from somebody say that instead of having this sort of competitive hashing, you know, the whole value proposition is that you're competing with others and you're all burning power. Maybe we can come up with a different way. So you know, there are other ideas people are coming up with where it's not based upon first to a certain number of zeros in a hash, but you know, maybe a first to value performance, randomization. So you randomly give people the opportunity to be the head of the chain. However, then you have to trust the company that's offering that, and Intel and all those companies. So if you trust Intel, you say, okay, I will let Intel be the custodian of the ledger, you can at least get rid of this power consumption. Because the fundamental issue with Bitcoining is, right now, it's already the power reading somewhere that it's the total amount of energy being consumed in Bitcoin is already greater than the energy consumption of a large city. And at the current rate it's going, by 2020, it could be the size of a small country. So the biggest Bitcoin operations are in Inner Mongolia, where you have the cheapest power. So this is a very interesting case study, because it kind of translates to money. And this is a situation where the whole value proposition here is a race for energy efficiency. And you see a natural progression from general purpose to parallelism and a specialized kind of parallelism. This is a very nice application for a GPU. To an ASIC. And it works in this case. So yes, the CPU roadmap continues, but it's, for this specialized application, there's a whole different segment. And you have a different way of doing energy efficiency. So we come back here then. We already talked about the value performance of all these segments. But there's something else that's missing in here, which could be the next source of value performance. I already have the hint up here, right? Data to information. All of this is generating tons of data. And that data is useless unless you can process it into some kind of information. And eventually you're going to process the information into knowledge. Now all of a sudden you have a way to monetize essentially raw parallelism and data. And you can take it and generalize it and say that I can take data from anywhere, I can do some analytics on it, and I can provide different kinds of value performance. So that's going to be the next wave now of how you take advantage of the growth. Now, I think Nick, you had asked me to kind of think a little bit about, talk about machine learning as an example, right? So I didn't want to go into too much detail on that because I saw Trevor is coming here next week, or next week. And he'll say a little bit more about this, I'm sure. I think the title of his talk is Explosion in AI Architectures. And I believe that, thinking about this, I think that what I just showed you in the case of crypto, this similar pattern that happens there. You start with a new application domain. It's completely new. So there's been a lot of interest in it, rapid growth, quickly approaching some level of maturity, and the winner is the one who can go to it the fastest. So you do it on a general purpose platform. Now, when a certain scale is reached, then you have venture companies, you have companies within a bigger company that are willing to fund a specific organization. You say, okay, experiment. Come up with something that's more specialized for that particular application domain. But it only makes sense once you reach a certain scale because you have to make money from it. But then there's a period of time when you're experimenting with alternate special architectures. During the initial phase, you can still charge a lot of money for the performance you're getting. So this leads to a Cambrian explosion, right? The original Cambrian explosion 500 million years ago, all kinds of life forms evolved. They filled up every niche, and I think it was probably because there was more oxygen in the oceans at that time, right? So there was enough for everyone, all kinds of weird life forms evolved during that period of time. So we can think of this as all kinds of new specialized architectures. I have a feeling this is what Trevor will talk about. The explosion of AI architectures in this space. But then the market starts maturing. So the initial enthusiasts, the early adopters, they are maturing, they saturate out. And now growth is going to come from the mass market. And the mass market means that you have to go at a lower price point. So now you have profitability becomes a selection force. So back to the evolution analogy. Now you have a natural selection after the Cambrian explosion, and that leads to a mass extinction cycle. And only the most optimized and specialized life forms who are successful are going to survive. So that's what we will see in any field, right? So in the case of ASICs, Bitcoin is being these ASICs that will survive. But then market continues to expand, and now your profits are coming from sustained optimization and segmentation. That's where we are with a lot of power stuff, right? Then you have to go apply the same concept we talked about, turning things off, lower voltage, more smarter about it. You have to keep applying them, extracting performance from that. Until somebody comes with a new innovation, and it goes back. Now with AI, the one problem with this model in AI is that nobody really knows what the right answer is. Right? And you have to be, at this time, everyone is experimenting. And you need to be, it's better to be flexible. So probably the general purpose stuff will stay relevant for a longer period of time before somebody narrows it and specializes. So do we have some room for optimism, right? So there's another law, Hooven's law. This is a researcher at Stanford. And he looked at technology over the last 50 years. And despite the challenges with dendritic scaling, this is a sort of a corollary to the Moore's law. He's basically saying that the number of computations per unit of energy has been doubled. And then when we talk about dendritic scaling, that shouldn't just stop. He rewrote this paper, he said, okay, well, I was originally talking about peak power. If I think about typical power, then I can get back to the same trend. So people believe that Hooven's law will continue to hold. And this is basically saying that you have to figure out a way to deliver that value performance because it can't just be peak performance that matters. another interesting way of looking at it. So this is, you know, what's our ultimate challenge? This goes all the way up back to 1900s, from the starting of the analytical engine. And you look at the capability, you know, this calculations per second per $1,000. You can proxy, use power as a proxy for this. The same sort of logarithmic scale. From that time up till now, not, it's not just in the since the Silicon Age, even prior to that, if you go back, the fact remains that we are on this curve. What's the ultimate goal? Some people think the ultimate goal is the human brain. Okay. Right? I think most people, you may have your own concerns about Skynet coming to life and the Matrix. But if you're a technologist, one way or the other, whether you realize it or not, you are essentially working towards this. You are working towards Skynet. When the doomsday comes, you're all powerful. Something has already happened, right? March 2 years ago, the Google DeepMind, it beat the human champion for Go. And Go is supposed to be a lot more complex than chess. Okay, so that's our ultimate challenge. So what has this got to do with power? My belief is that this is also the ultimate power challenge. The human brain is 20 watts, approximately. I saw this on the web, it was really funny. Right, so AlphaGo is like 1,000 CPUs, 400 GPUs. The total amount of power consumption, you know, took an army of scientists. On the human side, one cup of coffee. So there's a megawatt at 20 watts. And this megawatt was for some tech, all it does is play Go. It does nothing else, right? And in fact, it's not even physically moving the pieces. The human being can do a lot more for 20 watts. So what is this gap? How do we go from here to there? And it's not going to be just about, well, we can keep increasing the number of neurons in our network, and that'll be enough. You'll have to figure out a way to do it at a very energy efficient way, otherwise it won't happen. So within that context then, do we have research opportunities in power? Yes, but we have to think a little different. Think about value performance. You need cross-domain expertise. A lot of the innovations are coming where people are making connections between different areas and figuring out that the next opportunity or that edge comes not from just keeping doing the same thing again and again, but looking at an adjacent domain, borrowing some ideas from there. Keep pace with the new usage models. So, you know, the home, the office, a lot of need for collaboration, opportunities in that model, of course, cloud, AR, VR, and eventually AI, cyber physical, right? All of, you think about what's happening and then try to stay ahead of the curve. To exploit energy efficient performance. Parallelism will continue, but it has to be energy efficient. Specialized acceleration, that's again, hopefully I've convinced you that there's always a value proposition for specialized acceleration. But it has to come at the right time and for the right value proposition, but there's always options there. And they will never, the need for fundamentals of power-based design will never go away. Smart design, looking for the last milliwatt, thinking about how you segment your design, the hardware-software partitioning, dynamic power management, all of those ideas which have existed, they all are relevant, and we can keep taking them and translating them into different domains, and they will still apply. And by the way, all of this is, we talked about power consumption, getting power into the chip, that's a whole another area that's equally important. Back to the dark silicon. Right? So we said, okay, we can add big little. I can add a big core, a small core. I have transistors anyway. I just turn them off when I need them. I turn them off when they're not needed. I turn them off when they're needed. But what if you come with an application that actually can take advantage of both at the same time? Or you have certain latency sensitive things that you say, I need all of these things together. So all of a sudden, all your dark silicon is lit up, and now you cannot supply the power consumption. That's some of the things I'm working on right now actually are more related to this. Because this continues to be a problem. And then power source management, whether you are using batteries. Batteries are running out of the ability to deliver power. At the beginning of this year, did people read the news about the whole fiasco with Apple? When they did an OS update, people started seeing performance losses. And if you pay attention to that. Became a big hot news item. What was going on there? Basically, batteries in older iPhones were wearing out. And by the way, don't say that I said this to you. You can look for the internet sources. Batteries were wearing out, which meant that they couldn't supply the peak current capacity that they originally were designed for. And so they dynamically, they basically went and, in that part of software upgrade, the older iPhones, the performance was reduced so that they don't hit those peak conditions. So power source management. So that we can move on. So call to action. We need to address power at all levels, right from the technology all the way to the architecture. Think in terms of integration. And more importantly, how you deliver value performance. First word. That's the most important. So yes, we'll continue to talk about power. We'll continue to have ISLPD and conferences on power. It's just you have to think this way. I think we finished just on time.
Thank you. For an excellent talk. Let's take maybe one or two questions. We're running over, but if there's a burning question or two, we can address that. If not, let me ask one question. We've had a number of people come in recently who've been looking at the notion of non-volatile processors. The idea that you can exploit these newer memory fabrics, and then you can rethink architectural models where power is not there all the time, but power is available intermittently. So is there, are there activities in the industry, in large companies, that are looking at that as an option? Such as ones that start with I?
Well, yes. The short answer is yes. I think starting with the NVRAM is very good. Phase change memory and NVRAM, right? This is back to the fundamental business problem. Right now, how do you deliver value performance with that capability? Right? Now you have the capacity to have a really large memory, which is approaching the latency of DRAM. How do you take advantage of that? Well, this is not a hypothetical. I mean, this is a fundamental question. One answer you get, won't take a shot at the one answer everybody gives. How do you use a really large memory which has the latency of DRAM? Is there any database people here? In-memory databases. And it's like we get tired of hearing it. It's okay, we've got in-memory databases. Okay, so maybe Oracle will be a customer. What else, right? So that goes back to computer architecture. I think it's a way of, okay, what are those problems? And what fundamental architecture changes, right? I think this is back to our memory, specialized memory architecture, right? Where we would argue about this and say you're never going away from that model of memory. But now you have to do that. So yes, it's a area and it's a great opportunity. If somebody is working on that, can come up with a very compelling business model, we would love to hear. Because right now it's in that race between how do you get paid for something that people right now don't really know how to use. We are using the disk caches. Now that's working well. Octane memory, it's a simple use case. You don't really have to change software for it. Where you have to change software fundamentally.
Are you going to eventually integrate Pyro with Helix cells to try and be able to do more with less power?
What's that again? I didn't
Pyro with Helix cells. It's a technology that is able to capture heat off the metal and recycle it back into power structures.
I hadn't heard about this one,
okay.
But yeah, if there's one message out of this is, right, there's a need and an opportunity for all of these areas where you can figure out a new way of extracting performance or extracting power or extracting efficiency. So I don't know that battery technology,
okay.
But yeah. Ambient computing, if we talk about ambient or energy harvesting, That's important. It's very in the specialized area of sensors, right, and smaller IoTs. That's a big deal there. So, and then you have that as the energy harvesting, right, which is the other big area of battery research. Cars, Teslas, right, solar energy. So that whole spectrum of battery research is like all the way from your micro watts up to megawatts.
So maybe just in the interest of time, perhaps we'll let's thank Dr. Tiwari again for an excellent talk.